Ladies and gentlemen, we would like to start part two of the 2018 Goi Peace Foundation Forum. It is a panel session entitled From Intention to Action. We'll be inviting comments from three young people who are tackling various social challenges. So we would like to call upon the panelists to take the stage. First, Mr. Eigo Matsuzaki, Ms. Sayaka Murata, and Mr. Kazuma Nishitsuji. We have a round of applause for our three panelists, please. Thank you. We are joined by the chairperson of the Goi Peace Foundation, Mrs. Masami, Saionji, and president as well, Mr. Hiroo, Saionji. So we'd like to start. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. We'd like to start part two of our program. In part two, we had the essay contest. We also had the reading of wonderful essays today. And we heard from the laureate of the Goi Peace Foundation Award, Her Royal Highness Princess Lalla, Hasnaa. We had a most inspiring speech from our laureate. I'm sure the members of the audience were most inspired by that lecture. Thank you so much, Your Highness. So I would like to introduce the title and the persons who are taking part in part two. I'll just read their names and their title. To your right is with the General Secretary of Japan Blind Football Association, NPO, Mr. Eigo Matsuzaki. And next to Mr. Matsuzaki is the co-founder and the director of Kamonohoshi Project, Ms. Sayaka Murata. And the president and CEO of a company called My Farm, Mr. Kazuma Nishitsuji. These three young people, their young people, are tackling various issues and challenges in their respective fields when in the face of social challenges. So in part two, in this relay talk fashion, or panel discussion fashion, we would like to hear from these three panelists. But before we have these panelists talk, I would like to give more detailed explanation. And also Chairperson Mrs. Masami Saioji will offer her comment at the very end of their presentations and comments. So that's how we would like to proceed with the program. So this is the panelists for part two, the Four Japan Supporting Corporation. So before we hear from the three panelists about their initiatives, as I mentioned at the outset, perhaps I could take this opportunity to share with you some of the activities for youth education that are being implemented by the Goi Peace Foundation. At the Goi Peace Foundation, under the philosophy that everybody is a citizen of the globe and therefore share common mission and responsibility, especially we wanted to make sure that young people and children are able to leverage their characteristics so that they can contribute to a peace and sustainable society. That is what we are encouraging. And based on this philosophy, we have been carrying out various programs. First, the international contest for the youth, for which we announced our first prize just earlier. We are marking the 19th year for this contest, and we are receiving submissions in 5 different languages. And every year we set different topics, if you will, and themes for the essay contest. The intention is that we wanted, the intention is, we really wanted to give the opportunity to each people to think seriously what they can do for a better world and take a step forward. And the next initiative is called the Youth Citizen Entrepreneurship Competition. This is an essay we already talked about the essay contest, but this entrepreneurship competition is actually a competition of projects for a better society, although we use the term competition. We not only provide awards for outstanding practical projects being carried out by the young people, we are actually carrying out training programs where young people can learn about social entrepreneurship, and we are carrying out such programs. There are two categories for this competition, and the projects for which it is already projects that are already implemented, and also the idea for projects. For this year, we received 650 projects have qualified from 93 different countries. And one, and for example, in the idea category, a youth project that attaches devices made from recycled plastic deposits and generate power using water current in Jordan was the winner for the idea category. And also for the category of projects that are already being implemented, the youth project to prevent sexual violence using arts and sports in Kenya was the winner of this award. Now, next is the ESD program. ESD means Education for Sustainable Development. In other words, this is an educational program to create talent that can indeed be the cornerstone of the sustainable society going forward. This is a project that has been led by UNESCO. And in 2014, when the first UNESCO World Conference on ESD was held in Nagoya in 2014, at the opening ceremony, we had the privilege of hearing the keynote speech from Her Royal Highness Princess Lalla Hasnaa. At the Goi Peace Foundation, as a key partner for UNESCO, we are carrying out cooperation for ESD promotion in the youth category. And also here in Japan, under the joint auspices with the Ministry of Education, we host the ESD Japan Youth Conference every year. And we're creating a platform where young people throughout Japan who are tackling various social challenges in different categories can come together, learn from each other, collaborate, and create a new tide in the society. And so we are involved in creating such a platform. Next is the Earth Kids Space Program. This is an after-school program geared toward elementary and secondary school children. It's an after-school project. So through creation and outdoor activities, and also interaction with the members of the local public, children can learn about the value of life, and also the value of nature, and also the value of peace. The intention is to generate, if you will, universal values as well as qualities as a global citizen. This has been operated by volunteers throughout Japan on weekends as well as after school. And these days, in 5 different locations outside Japan, we are having participants for this program. So it is now of a global scale. Next is the school lecture by diplomats. In the audience today, we are blessed with the attendance of many members of the diplomatic corps in Japan. We're able to have lectures by ambassadors as well as diplomats, senior diplomats, through the cooperation rendered from the various embassies based in Japan. And also they allow various students to visit their embassies. This indeed is a very live international understanding education. And as part of that, we have a Cultural Diversity in a Globalized World lecture series by ambassadors at the Gunma Prefectural Women's Universities. And more than 100 different countries' ambassadors and diplomats have participated in this program. And it's a very popular program. We'd like to express my sincere gratitude to the cooperation run by many different members of the diplomatic corps today. And also, as was mentioned at the opening, in terms of school exchange with Morocco, allow me to say a few words about that exchange. We have signed a memorandum of understanding with the Mohammed VI Foundation for Protection of the Environment. This will connect schools between Japan and Morocco. And we're going to have exchange program based on various topics as well as the environment. Already some of those programs have been launched. The first exchange is between a school called Abdel Momen Elementary School in capital Lavato that is promoting the exchange program for the exchanges between Abdel Momen Elementary School and K International School in Tokyo. We've already visited the school, by the way, and they would introduce their initiatives pertaining to the World Environment Day and International Day of the Ocean through videos, and they're giving thought as to what contribution they can each make. The second exchange is with another eco school in Morocco. It is with Hizam Akudara Primary School and a school called Omori 6th District Secondary School, which is known for its innovative ESD program. They exchange video letters, and they would actually introduce their environmental protection activities through the video. Just so happens that yesterday, Her Royal Highness Princess Lalla Hasnaa actually visited this Omori Secondary School, and she had the chance to have direct interactions with the students. They introduced innovative projects. She also saw Japanese arts as well as martial arts being introduced at the Omori 6th School. I understand that the principal of the school is in the audience today. Indeed, for the children and the students, this is a life, a once-in-a-life event, something that they will never forget, and they were most inspired and touched by Her Royal Highness's visit to the school. Going forward, we would like to continue to pursue direct school exchange, inclusive of exchanges of outstanding initiatives in environmental schools such as was ESD, and develop that into joint projects down the road. So as you can see, at the Goi Peace Foundation, through various projects, we are trying to foster, and also through cooperation with international networks, we would like to foster within children and young people a mindset to love peace and the mindset to want to contribute to people and to society. And we hope that we can support them to translate that into actual actions. That is our wish. So that is the introduction of Goi Peace Foundation's youth-related educational programs. Thank you for listening. So without further ado, we'd now like to turn to the presentations by three young speakers. And first, we'd like to invite Mr. Eigo Matsuzaki. When he was a student, he came across the so-called blind football or blind soccer. He wants to create a society that can mix both people who are blind and people who are not impaired. In other words, separating visually impaired and those who are not. That should not be condoned. He wants to promote something that can create a mix between the two. These two type of people should not be distinguished. We should have an inclusive and diverse society. That is what he aims to create. So without further ado, Mr. Matsuzaki, please.
So first, I would like you to watch this video.
My name is Matsuzaki from Japan Blind Football Association. It's a privilege to be here. What you have seen on the screen
Morocco was taking part in those games. In global ranking, Japan is 9th and Morocco is 7th in the world ranking. So two positions above Japan. By 2020, possibly Paralympic Games, when it is played in Japan, Japan may fight against Morocco. So those of you in the audience today, please root for both of the teams, both for Japan and for Morocco.
Now, today, we have shown you that video, and what I would like to do, well, actually, I don't intend to talk about actual play of blind football, but I want to talk about the potential that the parasport has for everyone. My first question to you, do you have inferiority complex? You have the feeling that you are inferior from other people, or you envy somebody else because somebody else has something that you don't have? I'm sure everyone has such complexes. For me, I'm short. So that has been my inferiority complex. At least that's what I was when I was small. From grade 1 to grade 6, I was the shortest in school. We have foreigners here, but in Japan, you have stand in the order of your height. And for 6 years in the grade school, I was the very front kid lined up. That was me at the front of the line. I wasn't comfortable being the shortest. And when you're short, that was my inferiority complex. And for me, this was as if it was a penalty. Because the shortest children in school, the three shortest kids would have to hold hands with children with disabilities to take part in school activities. For example, in observation trips and school trips. So I was short and I needed to hold hands with the children with disabilities because I was short. So on an excursion trip, I would go someplace and I would let go of that hand and join my other friends. So on an appearance, I would appear as if I was living together with children with disabilities. But in my mind, I wasn't willing to. And Mitchan was the name of a girl who had disabilities who I had to hold hands with, but for 6 years, I didn't know what her disabilities was. So that was the kind of kid I was in school. So when you ask somebody, how much prejudice do you have with somebody with disabilities? I would hold her hand, but when I play, I wouldn't play with her. Still, relatively speaking, probably I would have answered that I wouldn't have that prejudice. And not many people are willing to answer yes to this question, whether you have prejudice or not. People would say that they don't have prejudice. We call this manifest prejudice, prejudice that is visible to the outside world. People would normally say that they don't have prejudice. Now think about this. A, disabilities. B, able-bodied. When you hear the word crutches, where do you classify, either A or B? Whom? What about whom? Disabilities or able-bodied? Try to do the same here. Here, A says disabilities or the strong, and B is able-bodied or the weak. And rugby, when you hear the word rugby, where do you classify? A or B? What about regular employees, A or B? Possibly, I would say that you might find it difficult to classify this. Can you raise your hand if you find it difficult to classify? You might want to ask that the question is wrong. Classifying into disabilities of the strong and the able-bodied and the weak. The question might be wrong, you might say. And that discomfort that you felt, please remember that discomfort because I want you to take a look at this one. A is for people with disabilities or the weak, and B is able-bodied and the strong.
entrepreneur would belong to A, and wheelchairs would probably belong to B. So the first question and the second question, we just swap the words, disabilities and the strong, disabilities and the weak. Before we knew it, we would associate disabilities and the weak. We take that for granted because we associate disabilities and the weak. When you associate disabilities and the strong, you feel that the question is wrong because these are the notions that are not readily associable because that is how we were educated. It's not necessarily the wrong thing, the bad thing, but the precondition here is that we still have stereotypes and prejudice when it comes to the matter of disabilities. Disability is oftentimes associated with pity, stigma, not being able to do some certain things, and being weak. That is the negative prejudice that we may have in our environments. Now, I talked about manifest prejudice. Well, you might say that you can hold hands with people with disabilities because you don't have manifest prejudice, but there is latent prejudice. Latent prejudice, people have that. So how do we approach that to try to make a change? Well, when I was in elementary school, to understand children with disabilities, I was forced to hold hands with her. That was external motivation. There was this educational norm. Because of education, well, in schools, we were told that we have to live together with people with disabilities. And because I was short, I was the child who was forced to hold hands with children with disabilities. My prejudice was not manifest. I would hold hands with her, but after I go to a destination, I would let go of her hand, and I would play with my normal friends. So my prejudice was just not manifest. So how do you approach latent prejudice? Earlier, the pictures that I show you, parasports, blind soccer. If you don't have sight, you might not be able to run. You might not be able to play soccer. This is the notion that we have without our knowing it. But this is an encounter that is impactful enough to change our notions. Look at the boy's face expression with mouth open. It's so impactful, that blind soccer. That is exactly what blind sports is about. And interestingly enough, in order to understand disabilities, if you just use parasports for the purposes of understanding disabilities, it becomes external motivation. This is what we're doing in elementary school. Children were blindfolded and asked them to play a game to achieve something. Through teams, they are to work toward a common goal, and people with disabilities would join them so that through this diversity education, they are allowed to understand disabilities. And through blind soccer, we're trying to approach latent prejudice, make a change. That's the potential of parasports, crossing the boundaries between able-bodied and people with disabilities. So our vision is that through soccer, visually handicapped and able-bodied people can mix in our society. That's our vision. That's the vision of our activities. If you encounter people with disabilities, hold hands with them. There was a classmate who was visually handicapped, but I never spoke a word with him in university. Why am I here when I was somebody like that when I was in school? That's the power of sports. I watched blind soccer and I was so impressed. I wondered how they are able to play that game. And I actually experienced that. And I was able to understand what disabilities was about by experiencing that. That's the power of blind soccer. Towards 2020, you will have many opportunities to actually experience and watch para sports. Don't just feel sorry for people with disabilities. Remove the notion, your fixed notions about disabilities. Have awareness so that we can create a society where people can mix together. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Matsuzaki. As for myself,
Back in my school, yes, we used to line up by height. I used to be at the front of the line. I know I can sympathize what you went through. So let us go on. I'd like to invite Ms. Sayaka Murata. When she was at university, she visited Southeast Asia, and at that juncture, she saw poverty. How families with poverty can experience child trafficking. And at the age of 20, together with her colleagues, she launched the Kamono Hashi project. She's now supporting job creation for the parents' generation, to prevent poverty. And she's also supporting training of the police. And she's tackling something very challenging. She's trying to guide a very challenging issue to a conclusion. And she has received award for her courage. So, Ms. Murata, the floor is yours. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Thank you so much for this opportunity. My name is Murata. I'm the co-founder and director of the Kamono Hashi Project. Thank you for this opportunity. Well, we heard from Japan Blind Football Association. And we also, thanks to the support of Japan Blindfold Association, we had a trial where people actually put on blindfold. It's scary just to walk. But you have a guiding partner next to you, and that partner can guide you to a good direction. There's a sense of confidence. We can have good team building. So in your companies that you work in, or in your schools, and also on an individual basis, you're able to experience this. So please try this blind walking, which is sponsored by the Japan Blind Football Association. Thank you so much. So what are we doing at our NPO? We want to eliminate issues where children are sold. So what does this issue entail? Children, they're tricked into prostitution in brothels or because of poverty at their families. This is a very serious human rights issue, but we really want to eliminate this. And at the age of 20, I launched this foundation and this project. It's been 17 years old. You can do the math. I'm now 37 years old. So I've been involved in this initiative for the last 17, 18 years. So why did I begin this initiative? When I was in university, I actually heard about an episode of a young child who was sold into prostitution at class. And we were given a news article. This child was only 1 year younger than I. And from Myanmar, she was sold into prostitution in Thailand, according to this article. We were distributed this article as well as this picture. The girl's name was Misha. At the age of 12, she was sold. She actually had to go to work in Thailand. She comes from a very poor family. Her mother is already gone, and her father is disabled and cannot work. So to support her many siblings, at the age of 12, she actually went to Bangkok as a nurse. However, she was tricked into prostitution, into brothel. But when she found out, she could not get away. At the age of 12, she was abused. She was sick. She actually contracted AIDS as a result of prostitution. At the age of 20, she was actually in the terminal phase, and she was being taken care of at an NGO, but it was too late for her. But when this picture was taken, she only had 6 months left to live. She was 20 years old, and she was actually being interviewed by a Japanese newspaper. She said that she had a dream. She wanted to go to school. She wanted to study. That was her dream. And she wanted to be a policewoman, and she wanted to stop and children like herself being sold into prostitution. She never went to school, and at the age of 20, she passed away. When I heard this anecdote, she was only 1 year younger, but we are living in the same earth. We are living in the same era. We're all women. I heard that this could happen to someone like her, and I tried to delve further as to what was going on. What was shocking was that she was sold at a point at a 10,000 yen, or only 3,000 baht. 10,000 yen, it's equivalent to the price of the cloth that I was wearing. So a university student can, she was, so this girl was being trafficked at an amount which could be accessible by a Japanese university student. And there are such 1 million such children out there in the world. I really wanted to know if that was really the case. So when I was, and I went to Cambodia. Now this is from 2003. This is from a news program in the United States. In 2003, Cambodia was still in poverty, and if you go to buy if you want to buy a child in brothels, a 5-year-old, a 9-year-old child prostitute will actually appear. She was actually being forced to work in this brothel. They were 5 and 9.
Now,
these young children don't want to work on their own volition. They didn't come on their own volition. They were forcibly taken here. They were isolated, and they were abused and forced to work. So that was the situation back in the early 2000s. And I really wanted to eliminate this, and I created this organization. I've been active since the age of 20. And from 2004, we've been involved in Cambodia. So what have we done? Not let people sell or buy children. In order to do that, it's important that we provide jobs for poor mothers in rural communities. For example, families who are susceptible are actually single-parent families in rural communities. The mother is 40 years old and 11-year-old son. Very small. They can only have one food per day. So therefore, we wanted to make sure that the mother can have a stable income. So we wanted to create jobs for them. So 7 years later, you can see this wonderful house being built in the same place. They were now able to have 3 healthy meals a day. The children can go to school because the mother has an income. So this is what we've been doing. And at the same time, unless we could reduce the number of perpetrators, the number of victims cannot go down. So we wanted to support the police in order to reduce the perpetrators. We wanted to provide education to change the awareness and the mentality of the police people. Of course, the multilateral organization was already involved, but we also became involved and we provided support to the police. Through training, what we would do is to promote arrest of perpetrators and the protection and of the victims. And the number of arrests increased as a result. At the end of the day, in the past, roughly 30% of the people who were sold into trafficking prostitution was less than 18. But now, it's only 2%. So the percentage of children under the age of 18 has been reduced. So now it is said that in brothels, very little children being trafficked into slavery, into prostitution. Now, through efforts from many different countries, in a short period of time, Cambodia was able to improve the situation. The government introduced new laws, and the police are now going after the perpetrators. And through economic growth, poverty was reduced. And so the number of children sold into prostitution has come down. So therefore, if a lot of people can cooperate, we can solve these issues. That is our impression. So next, we looked into other countries with similar problems. Unfortunately, within some parts of India, this type of issue remained, so we expanded our activities. So what are we doing? So we wanted to go after the survivors, people who actually survived this situation. We're providing support to the so-called survivors. We respect them because these are people who overcame these difficulties. We provide counseling and also dance-based therapy so that people who went through this trauma can, through recovery, many of them, when they go back to their villages, they are susceptible to prejudice. So we provide support through those rural communities. So they're victimized, overcoming these trauma, and now some of them have emerged as leaders. So from victim to survivor, and from survivor to leader, we will provide support to these type of people. So these children, within their villages, they can warn the members of the community about the dangers of leaving their families and their communities. And also people who are victimized, they are, of course, taken care of and they're taken into custody. So these survivors can actually offer mental support and can also provide advice for improving the situation to the caregivers. So these people can come to the core of creating better solutions, and they can actually communicate that to the society and to the community. So people who have been traumatized, they can become leaders and can support their communities. That situation has arisen. So in order for, we would also like to support from Japan so that India society can be even a better society. We'd appreciate your further support. That is all for my presentation. Thank you for your kind attention. Well, thank you very much, Ms. Murata. That's outstanding. You were 19. This is a very serious, profound challenge, but you tackled these issues and challenges in a very bold and brave fashion. I salute you. Last but not least, I would like to invite Mr. Katsuma Nishitsuji. Mr. Nishitsuji, when he was a child, he actually saw he saw abandoned farmland when he was young. He really wanted to recover that land. And in 2007, he set up a company called My Farm Incorporated. So local production, local consumption, and with that as a motto, he is offering diverse program for agriculture and also providing experienced farms and agri-innovation colleges. He wants to bring agriculture closer to the people so that people can take interest in agriculture. And also, at the underlying philosophy is that although through IT, AI, and mechanization, through agriculture, people and nature can actually have greater interactions. He wants to create relations, better relations between agriculture and people. Mr. Nishitsuji, the floor is yours.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the introduction. My name is Nishitsuji from My Farm. Today, what I would like to do is, before I start my presentation, since there are many people here from abroad, there's a message that I want to convey to you. Today is November 23rd. Niiname Festival. Such a ritual is conducted on this day to appreciate good harvest. This is a very important day for agriculture. It's called the Harvest Festival. So it's a great honor for me to be able to speak on such a day on this stage. And I've heard very impressive messages today, so I'm encouraged myself. And before I start, when I was in high school, I was the shortest in class. I've always had to stand in the front of the line, so I can totally appreciate what you said. But before I start my main topic, these three people that have been invited to this forum, well, we are comrades for more than a decade, from 10 years ago when we were in mid-20s. We were trying to change the society. Each one of us have been working to try to make a change in the society. Ms. Murata talked about her age. We're in the late 30s now, so our activities have been conducted for more than 10 years now. So 10 years ago, we had this vision of trying to make a change in the society, and gradually these are now being implemented. So I believe this is an opportunity to share with you what we have been able to do. So let me start with my presentation. The company that I founded is called My Farm. This is with the wish of creating a world where we can have self-production and self-consumption. People ask whether we are an agricultural company, and my answer is, my company is to create a society. The company was started back in 2007, and there is one keyword that we have maintained over the years. We have been honing this keyword, deploying that in our business and spreading this in the society. What is the word, the keyword? Well, as was introduced, the keyword is self-production, self-consumption. We're trying to create such a society. The essence here is that initially, the earth, we have this earth, and there are creatures living on the earth, and humankind is just one of the species. And the humankind, in order to live on this earth, we have been doing all kinds of activities. So there's the earth and there's nature, and we humans live in this nature, on this earth. That was the starting point. But today, if we look at the society, we have two distinct separation between humans and nature. It sounds like a joke, but some of you may find it difficult to understand, many children today wonder if carrots grow on trees. Well, most of you might think that that's not possible, that's a joke. But peanuts, do you know how they grow? Many people don't know. I'm sure that in the audience, many people do not know how peanuts grow. So nature and agriculture, we're losing understanding about agriculture and about nature. And is that the right society we want to have? We want to bring humans and nature together, closer together. That is what we do at the company. There are students in the audience, so I would like to give a message to you. This keyword, self-production and self-consumption, this is a term that we coined 12 years ago, and we have been maintaining this key slogan. And as we send this message every year, over one year after another, this year, this term was carried in the dictionary, in the Japanese dictionary, for the first time. It's very important to continue to send the same message and to keep on working on the same initiative. You will be recognized by the society. So the young people in the audience, I want to tell you that you can do this if you keep on doing what you believe in. Let me talk about what this self-production and self-consumption is about. Let me read this out. The enjoyment and the joy that you get from coming into contact with nature, living together with nature, working in the nature, how beautiful it is, eating the products of nature, having conversation about nature, to appreciate nature. As people grow crops, people are grown by nature. That is the definition of this society of self-production and self-consumption. And in order to realize this kind of a society, we are engaged in all kinds of activities. And the intent is the theme of today's session. So let me talk about why I am doing this. Actually, I was born in Mikunicho in Fukui Prefecture. Etchizen crabs are in season at this time of the year. My parents, or my father, was a salaried worker. And this Mikuni region in Fukui Prefecture, the inhabitants are mostly farmers or fishermen. So I was belonging to a minority because my father was an office worker. So I envied farmers and fishermen. I thought that was more cool. So my inferiority complex was that my father was a worker in a factory. That was my inferiority complex. He wasn't a farmer or a fisherman. So that was my inferiority complex. But I didn't give up then. What I mean by that is that in my backyard, I could create a farm, I thought. So I turned my backyard into a little farm, and I would grow vegetables there. This is when I was 5 years old. I don't think I haven't changed much, have I? I'm chubby-faced even today. And this is me, 5 years old, and I'm growing radish on my own. The beauty of agriculture is that you can grow a radish even if you're 5 years old or 100 years old. So this is wonderful work. I don't think there are too many professions that can be done by people of all ages. And I encountered the wonder of agriculture. I wanted to continue that. And as I grew up, my turning point came when I was in first year of high school. When I was a freshman in high school, on my way to school, I found an abandoned farmland. And that was my turning point. In my backyard, I was growing vegetables in small scale. But looking around the world, there are many abandoned farmlands across Japan, about 10% of farmland in Japan. 400,000 hectares of farmland is not being cultivated. There is such surplus abandoned farmland. I want to do agriculture. There's no way I shouldn't do it. So when I was a freshman in high school, I decided that I would be a farmer. But my mother was quite cunning. My mother, when she heard that I wanted to become a farmer, she would ask me, what do you want to grow? And I wasn't able to give an answer right away. So I said that a wonderful crop is what I want to grow. And my mother said that it's wonderful that you want to grow a wonderful crop. You can win a Nobel Prize if you grow a wonderful crop. It's a meaningless conversation, but she said that if I'm able to grow a wonderful crop, you can get a Nobel Prize. And if you wanted to get a Nobel Prize, you have to go to Kyoto University. So my dream was to become a farmer, but then I had to turn it around to have a dream of becoming an innovator, going to this prestigious university. But when I would go to university, this is research that you have to work over a long term. I didn't want to do research. I just wanted to be a farmer. So I thought that I would just let the researchers do the research and I could go back to farming. When I was in high school, my parents agreed with my dream of becoming a farmer, but when I was a member of the working society, people would tell me, you shouldn't go into agriculture. So I decided to launch this business so that young people who wanted to do agriculture, I could develop a platform where they could join me. When you don't have farmland, I thought that I could develop a service where they can identify abandoned farmland. So I would develop a search website. And I would also develop a specialized school to learn about agriculture. And people may not have funds to start with. Then we would do agricultural equipment leasing service to lower the hurdle for people to engage in agriculture to grow vegetables. So this is what I do in my business. And as I was introduced, it's not just, it doesn't suffice just to produce agriculture and vegetables. There are buyers of vegetables. So they have to understand vegetables and agriculture before they are willing to make a purchase. I thought that this cycle is needed. So by making use of abandoned agriculture, we would give people experience of engaging in agriculture. Because of Harvest Festival of today, there are many events organized across Japan where people can try agriculture. We can do away with abandoned agriculture. We would have more people who are doing farming so that we can create a society where there is going to be self-production, self-consumption, which would lead to peace, world peace. And I thought that this kind of a program would be recognized in the world. So that is why I have been doing this for the past 12 years. So that was brief, but I just wanted to introduce what I do and my vision. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you very much. That's another outstanding presentation. So you heard from the three people, and the topic is from intention to action. So you heard from these three wonderful panelists. Everybody has a sense of awareness about issues that about issues. They want to address this. They want to make they want to rectify this. They want to change the world. They have such intentions to change the world. So many people actually share that, but to these three people actually translated that into action, and also they've continued on with that action. That I believe is where they most excel. So, Chairperson, would you like to offer your comment upon hearing the three people? You can refer to part or any part of their comments. So, the Chairperson, please. Thank you for your wonderful comments. Thank you so much for sharing your wonderful experience. So all of you, as well as the entrance to the essay contest in the children's category and to youth category, and Her Royal Highness's Princess Lalla Hasnaa's speech, they were all wonderful. And if I tried to synchronize all that was said, the common theme is that as we are born as human beings, there are so many different things that we want to do. But what do we choose? What is most suitable for us? Making that choice, making that joy, making that decision, that is up to each and every one of you. And all the people who gave their speeches, I get the sense that you know yourself. Unless you understand yourself, you cannot know what you want to do. You can, of course, comment what the others say. You can say, oh, that's wonderful, that's wonderful. Everybody on the news is wonderful. But and when you take a look at, come across, maybe you want to do everything that comes across your way. But then You have to know yourself before you can determine whether or not you can do certain things. Unless you do not know yourself, you cannot do anything. I can certainly say that with great conviction. So your sense of purpose, what you want to do, if you delve further, it means that you know yourself. You know so well about yourself. So that being the case, you have strong intentions. That's why you're able to take action. You can. There are many so different choices. I know that three of you probably had a lot of things that you wanted to do. But what can we do among those possible choices? We all envy what others do. We all think that what others do, we can also do. But then to continue with what you're doing and take responsibility for that and trying to bring so many people together. What is the ultimate goal? What is the ultimate intention? Yes, there are many different religions, race, languages, and borders. But cutting across all these differences, all of us want one thing. We want peace. And within peace, there are so many things we want to do in the face of peace. But at the end of the day, what do you want to do as an individual? All of you are here in the audience. You heard about different countries in the essay contest. But we all have a common underlying theme. It is so wonderful. There's so many wonderful people out there. But why is it that we see war? Why is it that there's air pollution? Why is it that we see nuclear power plants and also wars? Why? Governments can take various policies. We can blame the government. We can blame the business community. We can blame the CEO of different companies. We can criticize very easily. But what is important is, what do you want to do as an individual? Unless you know what you want to do as an individual, you're simply complaining and criticizing others. One can criticize, but then can you take action on your own part? Because you're not confident. You rely on others. You're dependent on others. And that has created the world today. You talked about farming, you talked about blind football, you talked about the speeches from our students from India and the Philippines, and we also heard about the Morocco. But the objective is the same. We have our wisdom. We have the ability to believe in ourselves. It is inside ourselves. We have wisdom. I have wisdom. I have love. I have joy inside my heart. I have something that can offer others. When all of that come together, then you're in a position to communicate what you want to do. Your sense of awareness of what you want to do can translate into hope and aspirations for others. You have all been successful because of that. When you see people who are successful, then people with different handicaps and different disabilities and difficulties can overcome the situation. They can overcome the difficulty. But why were they able to overcome? Is it because their parties helped them? Is it because the others simply agree with them? Of course, you need strong conviction on the part of the individual to gain the support of others. You need the ability to attract others. So that being the case, the sense that you want to make this world a better place, make Japan a better place, make the world a better place. We all have that awareness. We can criticize others, but we are all individuals. We create our nation. And it's important that the conviction of each individual is strong. We need to be convinced that we can do it. We have to start from there, believing that we can. We say that, oh, we're so small, we can't do it. One might say that others might say you can't do it, but do you have the conviction to do what you want to do? We are given life. I think what brings world peace is the sense that we all of us have very valuable lives. Differences in objectives, differences in religions and races. Yes, that can be overcome. We heard about different cases today. We heard about people with handicap. We heard about so many different episodes. We heard about prostitution and single parent families. You have chosen your topic. You want to save these different people. But the underlying thing, what is the underlying theme? Conviction of each individual. So what I want to ask is this. You have faced different difficult challenges, I'm sure. You've come across different anxieties. I'm sure you had times when you had to question yourself, but How did you derive the strength to overcome those questions? I wish I had the time to ask you, but I suppose we can only learn from people with experiences like yourselves. So we have aspirations, we have dreams. We can talk about that. But then, what is the most suitable path for us? We have to look into ourselves. It's easier to follow the instructions of others. It's like do as the Jones do. We can, if everybody does the same thing, we all feel safe. If we can all go across the street in red light, if as long as everybody goes together. So again, just that criticism. It's important that you have the ability to judge. You are a creator. You are a judge. You need the ability. You need to have the ability to judge yourself. You need a judge. You also need to be a legal expert. You also need to be a religious expert. You have to be all many things. So what I believe is most important is that you all have strong convictions. You know yourself. You know who you are. And you really want to work for the others. You want to make a better world. You want to do people for the others. That, I believe, is the topic. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you. We don't have a lot of time left, but to each one of you, lastly, let me just give you a quick question and get an answer from you. As the chairperson said, how did you manage to overcome various challenges? What motivated you? That's one question that was asked. And furthermore, the vision of the future that you have in your minds, if you could share that with us. And in order to create such a future, young people, through aged people or older people, maybe you may have a message to older people from a young person's perspective. How we can make a contribution. If you could talk about that one by one. May I ask you to make a comment? Yes, Mr. Matsuzaki, you will be the first one. Yes. Difficulty and challenges, overcoming challenges. As Mr. Mitsutsuji said, we've known each other for more than 10 years now. We have different social challenges we're trying to approach, and we are in different phases. So whether we can talk to each other about our business, well, no, because we're doing different things. But we feel close to each other. And I look at Mr. Mitsutsuji, and I'm impressed by how well he's doing. Why didn't I give up my dream? Well, we were talking about the difficulties that we faced in the past in the green room, but the reason we didn't give up our dream is, of course, there are people who are supporting us, and there are people who are benefiting from what we do. But we're tackling different challenges, and we're trying to better the society from different perspectives. And we had each other to support ourselves, even if we're not doing the same thing. That's something that I really felt today. And if I may, among the audience, there are people who are older than me, I'm sure, and in many cases, people tell me that you cannot do that, you're not going to succeed. But many people have all, at the same time, approached me, given me encouragement that I can do it. So whatever the generation you're in, you can make a contribution by encouraging people, giving encouragement and support to people crossing borders. Sometimes you might hesitate to do that, but you need to have the courage to encourage others, motivate others.
Thank you. Ms. Murata, please. Yes, thank you. Yes, the fact that we've been able to continue on for the past 17 years is that I just don't like to give up. In a nutshell, I just don't like to give up. I'm tenacious, but there are many difficulties. But abandoning what we did, we've actually, on three separate occasions, have abandoned what we did. For example, we created PC class, but then that did not eliminate victims. So therefore, we decided to change course and provide police training. And then we went out to India. So actually, our course really changed. So the first, when we closed the PC school after the initial phase, we thought that this could have been a failure, or this might have been a big failure, and we thought maybe I shouldn't have started this in the first place. Again, I lived in Phnom Penh in 2004, immediately out of university. I felt that I really could not fail. I involved so many people, so I really questioned whether or not I made the right choice, because I really couldn't pay salary. So I was actually drawing down from my own personal savings. So that was the situation. So it was a very difficult time for me. But I just don't like to give up, and that's why I've been able to continue. So why is it that I couldn't give up? I met, there was a six-year-old child who was a victim. She was sold at a pittance, and she was taken into custody. And I felt that I really wanted to change the world where such a thing could happen. 1 year later, she ran away from the center, and she went back to prostitution. Why? Because she saw her parents being hit by loan sharks. And she thought that she, rather than her parents, she should be the one to be abused. And that is something that's taking place globally. I simply happened to come across the case in Cambodia, and I just wanted to change the situation. She was being sold into prostitution for 10,000 yen. That was wrong. That's why I just couldn't give up. And then that's why I was able to continue on for the past 17 years. And also, what I would like to ask the elderly citizens are as follows. As was mentioned by Mr. Matsuzaki, so many people support me. That is why I'm standing on the stage today. And I've received many awards. That is because many of you have recommended me. Many of the supporters have recommended me. So many senior citizens said, oh, Ms. Murata-san might be a good candidate. And that's why I was recommended. So I would appreciate your continued support going forward. And I do hope that you will continue to be involved. That is what I would like to ask the veterans of the world. This issue is there. Not enough light is shed on this issue. I would appreciate your interest. Thank you so much.
Mr. Nishitsuji, please. Well, in my case, having listened to the earlier discussion, looking around the world today, partial optimal and total optimal. More and more people want partial optimal. They just want what is good for themselves, what is best for themselves. If you have more of such people, total optimum could be eroded. And that is what we are seeing today. Our activities also, the things that we have to do, and as we do it, we're trying to see what the role that we're playing in the society, what is the effect that we're bringing to the society. That is something that we're very conscious about. We're looking at the total picture and play the role that we play in the society. When we do such things, you have more supporters for you. That's what's good about it. If you're just seeking partial optimum, as we heard from Ms. Murata, girls are sold at a cheap price. And for the buyer, this buyer may say that he's helping out the family she's from. This is the extreme case of partial optimism. But what the impact will have on the society as a whole is not being looked at. But when you look at the total optimum, there will be more people who will support you. That is the motivation we have in pushing forward. So when you have difficulty, when you're down and you have difficulty, what I try to do is that I try to tell myself that I'm doing something good for the society. What I'm doing is not wrong for the society. I have that conviction. If there's any doubt in my mind that I may not be doing the right thing for the society, if I have doubts that people would not approve of what I do, then I probably would not have the motivation to move ahead. So I have to understand what my position in the society, what my role is in the society. That's the secret to keep moving on. So another question that was asked, which was the message to the audience. Well, I've talked about partial optimum and total optimum. Well, today's society has a tendency of going toward partial optimum. An extreme case of that is that in agriculture, there's one big problem, which is that this week, from the United Nations, there is a declaration to support small farmers. And this declaration is one that came from Africa. But Japan abstained from approving that declaration because Japanese agriculture policy is to industrialize it, to have higher efficiency, to grow crops that will be globally competitive. That is the logic of the Japanese government. But that's only partial optimum. You're just looking at Japan. You're just looking and focusing on Japanese agricultural corporation. If you enhance that, then they will profit. And with that money, they can start new business. That is partial optimum. But if you look at the total optimum, the number of Japanese farmers has been reduced from 1.9 to 1.5 million from 2015. And it will go down to 900,000 in 2025. By inviting more investments to have more farmers, that's one thing. But we're living in an age where we need to be conscious of consumers. You want to eat fresh vegetables. You want to eat organically grown vegetables. You want to eat vegetables. You know who the farmers are. But there is a tendency to go towards industrialized agriculture. But if you look at total picture, agriculture is part of humans' life, supporting people in their life. So times are changing all the time. And therefore, you need to really understand and read the trend of things and have the total picture before you make a decision. So I do hope that my, if there is going to be a revision to the Japanese government's position on the declaration for small farmers, that would be great. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Last but not least, one word from the chairperson, and then we would like to conclude the panel discussion. Chairperson, well, thank you once again for the wonderful messages from the three panelists. My message is this. We have such young people. Why? We see so much on news and on television, but more than that, these people are trying to communicate about their own experience. Each individual connecting all the people. If we can share this episode, then we can change. So not just what's on the news on television, we need to translate into action. So we heard these wonderful experiences from the three wonderful speakers and also from the wonderful recipients and the members of the essay contest and, of course, Her Royal Highness as well. We heard so many wonderful things directly from these people. So communicate that, pass that on to others, and please take part where you can. I think that will lead to a situation whereby each individual can be the source to change the world. Thank you so much, and good luck to you all. Thank you very much. So we'd like to have a warm round of applause to our young three panelists. Thank you.
Again. Lastly, Chairperson and President of Goi Peace Foundation will make concluding remarks.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us today. And today we have the Harvest Festival, and the Imperial Highness at the Imperial Palace is carrying out such rituals today. He is encouraging farming. He's looking for peace of the world. Peace of the country and peace of the world. This is the day of such prayers. But the name is no longer there, but we still have the Harvest Festival. But we have such blood as Japanese. Thank you so much for setting aside your valuable time, despite the fact that it is a holiday. We really appreciate this wonderful attendance. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen.
Once again, thank you so very much. Today's theme is creating tomorrow today. We had a lot of discussion today. As you know, in 2001, at the UN, MDGs, Millennium Development Goals, were launched, and that was for 15 years, and 2015 was the year of sustainable development goals to be established, and there are 17 goals, including health, education, and poverty. In the framework of the United Nations, certain achievements have been made, but the UN and national frameworks, in addition to these frameworks, or even beyond these frameworks, each one of us as individuals have the mindset of trying to improve the society, have the ambition to change the society, and have a sense of responsibility to the next generation to take action every single day, as we saw from the example of the three young people. I think daily action, small action accumulated on a daily basis, is important to create a bright future for the next generation. Her Royal Highness Princess Lalla Hasnaa, thank you so very much for gracing us with your presence. The Peace Award goes to Her Majesty's Her Royal Highness's achievements. And thank you, everyone, for your support.